is ADBC. Tonight, my job is to steer two teams through the tumultuous waters of the past. Along the way, they'll earn points for correct answers or correct ones delivered with conviction. To my right is the AD team. Our first guest is an author and senior lecturer of Italian studies at the School of Languages and Linguistics at the University of Melbourne. Please welcome Dr. Andrea Rizzi.
Thank you. Andrea.
And next to Andrea is a writer, comedian, broadcaster. She's multi-skilled, and I know for a fact that it's always been a dream of hers to sit next to a doctor named Andrea. She is Michelle Laurie.
It's my birthday. Thank you.
Thanks for coming, guys. To the BC team, in 2008, she co-wrote The Great Feminist Denial. She's currently a lecturer at the School of History and Philosophy at the University of New South Wales. A big hello to Dr. Zora Simic. Hey, Zora. And sitting next to Zora, according to my research, our next guest is either a writer, director, producer, comedian, actor, or one of the last of the old Hollywood actor singers who performed alongside Fred Astaire and Judy Garland. We're going to find out tonight, ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Tony Martin.
Yes, thank you. Yes, you're quite right. I was married to Sid Charisse for 70 years. That's true.
Did you know that? You would have known that, didn't you? You Google yourself every day.
There's the Tony Martin that was married to Sid Charisse.
Yep.
There's the one from Black Sabbath. And there's somebody in England who, if you Google my name, keeps shooting people who break into his house. I don't want to be confused with that man, if possible.
Dr. Zora Simic, can you tell us a little bit about your research?
I'm working on growing up in the suburbs in the 70s and 80s. I'm arguing it was different than anything that came before, but I haven't been able to find any evidence about this thus far.
Is this... in suburbs in particular?
Yes. My case study is the western suburbs of Sydney, so Westies. So at the moment I'm looking at Ozrock, people going to pubs.
And I understand you're going to give us a demonstration of Sharpie dancing before the end of the show tonight.
Yeah. I think you're the one dressed for it.
That's what Zora. The BC team's sitting on.
Anyway, looking forward to our big finish of Zora Simic dancing Sharpie style at the finish. Dr. Andrea Rizzi, if you could go back to a particular time in history, where would it be?
I'd go back to my favourite time and favourite place, which are, Italy, in the Renaissance. I would probably be a translator. I would be doing lots of translations. I'd be paid a lot of money for it. Yep. I'd be free to change the text whichever way I like. That's the great thing about the Renaissance. And no one would have to tell me off or, cut the pay because I just did whatever I liked. And I'd probably be able to travel as well. So I think it's a great, great place to be.
On the downside, you're having to take a crap in the street. I think that's basically the problem with wanting to be an olden days historical figure.
Let's kick off the show with our first round. Each team will be presented with the origin of a popular phrase, term or saying and must try to identify what the phrase is. Andrea and Michelle, you can go first. This is a term that says something is based on a false assumption or absurd or exaggerated information. And it has its origins in World War I. Not enough?
No.
Keep going.
It derives from the company name written on water carts servicing the troops in Europe and the Middle East. These water carts were a gathering point as soldiers took advantage of the downtime to chat.
Talking water?
Definitely not. This is the last drop.
This is the last... Good, no.
No, that well-known phrase, talking water.
Talking water.
I can't... Thinking unfortunately, I can't get it. The drivers of the carts were also notorious sources of information, not always reliable, though, as they moved freely from camp to camp. And it was also the case that the rumbling of an approaching water cart sounded like the firing of artillery, thus causing a false alarm. This uniquely Australian term means an absurd or false assumption. It begins with F. Anyone?
Furphy.
No?
A furphy?
Furphy is correct.
Oh, well done. Exactly.
Well done. I had no idea that was uniquely Australian, for one thing.
Yes. No, and I picked up, too, that you had no idea what the answer was either. Very quickly.
It was coming.
It was coming. Water. Unfortunately, no points. No. I will say this. Mr. Furphy also wrote jingles on the side of his car. Want one?
Yeah.
Good, better, best. Never let it rest. Till your good is better and your better best.
There you go.
Isn't that inspiring?
Moments later, he was taken out by a sniper.
Zora and Tony, here are your clues. This expression relates to responsibility. Its earliest known use in print is from an 1865 edition of the Weekly New Mexican.
We were wrong.
No. No, it's not, but I'll give you another clue.
No.
The card game poker had become very popular in the US in the mid-1800s, and players were highly suspicious of cheating and so would take turns dealing in order to reduce the risk of bias. The player would be identified by a marker, often a knife with a handle made of a buck's horn.
The buck stops here. It's a desperate guess.
No, I thought it was a different buck.
Very close. Michelle?
Pass the buck.
Pass the buck is the answer. I think I've got a problem with the fact that in this potentially volatile situation where there's gambling, there's obviously tension because there's a possibility of cheating, they're passing around a knife.
It was just the done thing, really. It was rude to not.
Yeah, I don't think workplace health and safety was big.
So at the end of that round, Michelle and Andrea picked up 10 points and Zora and Tony also picked up 10 points. Well done, guys.
Thank you.
This is ADBC and we'll be back in a minute. Welcome back to ADBC. Moving on to our next round. Teams will be shown a postcard from a certain time and place in history. They must deduce what important or notorious moment occurred at this location. Teams, here's your postcard. Let's look at the back to see the postcard clue. The harbour's gone to pot since the White Devils came. The question is, where is this postcard from? Buzz in if you think you know the answer.
Oh, I think it's Shanghai.
No, but I can tell you that it is in China. It's 1839, if that helps.
Ah, that's too far ago. I thought it was during the first tour by Cheech and Chong. That was what I was leaning towards.
Amazingly, not that far off the mark, Tone, but the question is, where are we?
Is it? It's not Hong Kong.
No, it's not Hong Kong.
I think Hong Kong's quite recent. That's only been going about 10 years, I think. I think that's quite new.
This is Canton Harbour. And at the time, this was the only Chinese port open to foreign trade. Keep that in mind.
Right.
Because the next question is, what happened here? But I'll give you a little postcard clue. No more tea, Vicar. We've blown the kitty.
Right, we're going out at 7:30, aren't we?
We are.
Okay, right.
Yes. Yes. Why, what are you thinking?
No, I won't say anything.
Yeah, you're thinking carry-on movies, aren't you?
Constantly. Most of my historical information is gleaned from the carry-on series.
And this is carry-on up the Canton. The question is, what happened here?
There was a major strike, so the import-export, or rather export of tea was blocked, stopped.
Yes, and can you tell me what are the countries involved?
Michelle will finish that.
Michelle will finish?
England?
Yes,
I'm making that up. Is that real?
This is where Britain traded tea with China. So I'll give you 5 points.
Thank you so much.
And British trade with China started in the 1700s, but by the early 1800s, something had happened in terms of a trade imbalance involving tea.
Yeah. I thought there would be more questions about 80s movies. I just want to say that.
England drank too much tea because they love it so much.
That is right.
There you go. England drank too much tea.
Well, so Britain wanted all the tea in China, but they were going broke paying for it. Then they come up with a wild idea of what they could sell to China. And I'll give you a clue. Cheech and Chong, not that far off the mark.
Imported marijuana to China.
I can't believe that Cheech and Chong are going to bring this whole show down. But
how else is it Cheech and Chong related?
Think about a similar recreational drug.
Oh, this is the whole opium wars.
This story will come out eventually, I'm telling you. Don't worry. Essentially, Britain was dealing drugs to the Chinese. Instead of giving them money, they gave them opium and got about 12 million people addicted.
I'm still wondering about the tea. So everyone's got opium.
Yeah, I mean,
who's
why didn't
the
they just hang on to the opium and have the opium instead of drinking so much? I mean, more opium, Vicar? You know, that could have taken off.
Here's the next question. Why was there a war between China and Britain over opium. Let's look at one more postcard clue. The stash is in the drink.
Well, Michelle. Either the opium or the tea's fallen in the harbour, and either way, it's wrecked.
I'm going to give you that 10 points.
Thank you.
In an attempt to end the opium trade, the Chinese governor of Canton threw tons of British opium into the water. That kicked off the Opium War, which the British won decisively. The Chinese people, though, were furious at their defeat at the hands of the British, and this ignited a series of internal struggles in China that ultimately led to Mao taking over in 1949. So that's the Opium Wars, and that's what the British called free trading in the 1800s. I thought that mildly racist, but no one else did. That's fine. Wasn't there a Jamaican up the back smoking the air? Let's check the scores. Michelle and Andre, you're on 25 points.
Very good.
And Zora and Tony, you're on 10 points.
That can't be right.
Let's begin our next round. It's about crime and punishment. In this game, we'll present teams with a crime from history and three possible punishments. Only one is correct. Zora and Tony, you can go first tonight. Your question is, in ancient Rome, under Emperor Gallienus, the punishment for a jeweller who forged a precious stone was A, to be placed in a pit where the victims of the crime were permitted to stone the offender to death.
With his own jewellery.
B, to be placed in a sack with the false gemstones, then thrown in the river and pardoned of the crime if the sack floated. C, to be placed in the Colosseum, expecting to be attacked by vicious animals, only to be met by a chicken. But I'll give you some background. It's 260 AD and Rome is in the poo. The Emperor Gallienus is fighting off invasions around the empire and Rome is taking a tough stance against the Franks, the Gauls, the Hun and anyone else who wants to crash the toga party. It's mayhem and your challenge is where does a dodgy jeweller fit into the equation?
Well, that's right. You think they'd have their hands full to be worried about counterfeit jewellery. I would have thought at that point, but...
So A, B and C are up there. Zora?
Is it like a spectacle to take everyone's mind off invasion? And was... Or in which case, C, the chicken.
Exactly. Oh, and so that was just a hilarious gag when just a chicken comes out, just...
Yeah, everyone else was so worried.
...pecks away for a few minutes, nothing happens. People go, it's a bit of a boring show today. It's not normally what they turn on at the Colosseum. It's normally people being torn to pieces, not just a chicken pecking at the ground.
It could be.
Embarrassment being the punishment? I can't see how that works. I think just being placed in a pit, being stoned to death probably is the go. I can't imagine that the chicken is...
How many victims of the crime would there have been?
Well, that's right. I mean, I just can't imagine that meeting a chicken at the Colosseum was much of a deterrent.
No, it wouldn't seem.
Being placed in a sack with your goods that you've counterfeited, well, I mean, obviously if it was an anvil, that would be a worry, but some gemstone. I think it has to be being stoned in the pit, surely. Would you...
Happy with A, Zora?
No.
Yeah. No, I'm happy with A. I'm torn between A and C.
Wow. you are deferring way too much to that man.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I don't know.
Is that a clue?
You're going with A? You're going with A?
A, we'll go for A.
Oh, no.
The punishment for a jeweller who forged a precious stone was... C. Oh.
What the hell?
They were just trying to scare him.
But then what would happen after that?
Surely you can only play that card once. I'm forging some gems, don't worry. They'll just send the chicken out again.
I don't know, Tony. There's like four American Pie movies, dude.
Next time they were like, it might not be a chicken. They're expecting something else.
Push out a chest of drawers. It just gets something ludicrous every time.
The fraudulent jeweller was taken onto the floor of the Colosseum and placed in front of the Grand Gates, where he would have seen lions, tigers and elephants come through, only to be met by a chicken. The master of the games declared triumphantly, as this man has practised deceit, now deceit is practised on him. And the man was allowed to leave alive.
Boo.
Andrea and Michelle, here is your crime. According to the King James Bible, in the Old Testament, when the Ark of the Covenant was stolen in 1200 BC by the Philistines of Asdod, God's punishment was... A, smiting the men of the city with hemorrhoids. B, smiting them with rain powder and dust until the city was destroyed. C, smiting them with madness, blindness and astonishment of the heart. Smartness is involved. Some background. It's the Old Testament book of Samuel, and it's the subject of the film Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Well, I think hemorrhoids are a bit unlikely because, I mean, yeah, they're really tough and painful, but they go after a while, I guess.
But it was the olden days. They didn't have those blow-up seat things that the guys sit on, like...
I'm sort of tempted to go for the B answer, but...
Really? I actually like smiting with madness, blindness, astonishment of the heart because it's poetic and...
Poetic and more powerful.
Yeah.
Yes, yes.
It's kind of romantic in a weird way.
Yes.
Is there anything you don't find romantic?
No, I do find a lot of weird stuff romantic. Madness is very romantic.
Going with?
Insanity. C.
C? Oh, great. Yes, let's go with C.
I agree.
God's punishment to them was A.
What? Oh!
Really?
I mean, I have to say, that would have been a very poor ending to Raiders of the Lost Ark. They just jemmied the top off and then, oh, bloody hell, me arse. Steady on. We Nazis aren't going to be sitting down for a while.
Now, according to the Bible, in the book of Samuel, the Old Testament, he smote the men of the city, both small and great, and they had hemorrhoids in their secret parts. The hemorrhoids were so severe, some men died from them. Simultaneously, the city was overrun by mice who ate the food supplies. Let's face it, the last thing you want to be doing when you've got life-threatening hemorrhoids is to be bending over, placing mousetraps about the place. Here's a bonus question. 10 points if you know the answer. The priests advised the Philistines to return the ark with an offering to the Israelites. Does anyone know what offering to God needed to be provided?
Grapes.
Grapes.
Big, juicy ones.
Big, juicy, purple grapes.
Yeah. Read your Bible, mate. Check your Bible. You'll find.
Grapes are what it's all about?
Yeah.
It's in hemorrhoids 3 and 4, yes. If you want to look it up.
St. Mark's letter to the hemorrhoids.
The priest advised them to return the ark to the Israelites along with an offering to say sorry. And the offering was 5 golden mice and 5 golden hemorrhoids. After which, the hemorrhoids disappeared. We'll be back after the break to make some more history. Welcome back to ADC, where scores are close-ish. Michelle and Andrea are on 25 points, and Tony and Zora are on 10.
Thanks for reminding us.
On to our next round, with apologies to the great ponderer of man signs and symbols, Carl Jung. Symbols have been important to man throughout history. Their hidden meanings and messages have long intrigued our forebears. I'll ask some questions, buzz in when you think you know the answer. Can you tell me the name of this symbol?
It's the cross of the Templars. So it has to do with the Crusades.
It does.
But it's not probably not the Templars. But it has to do with the Crusades,
yeah,
doesn't it?
Yeah, it begins with M and it's a country and it's small.
Malta. Yes. Maltese. And that makes sense because of the order.
Maltese,
yes.
Cross, we got there. Well done, 10 points. The Maltese cross entered Western culture as the symbol of chivalry, of heroism and all things good. Question two. Where do we see it today? Andrea.
In churches. Some churches. Yeah. Very few churches, but you still see it in churches.
What? Gee, didn't I just break you down there?
Is the answer not in churches?
So that is the answer, not in churches.
It's not Red Cross, but it's like, it's something like that. It's like the ambulance.
Ambulance,
or...
well done, there 10 points, go. That is right. St. John's Ambulance Service and most ambulance services in Australia. Questions, what is the origin of the Maltese Cross?
I have this feeling, impression, that it has to do with the Crusades.
You
so
are...
with an order that was created in order to defend, protect not only the so-called Holy Land, but also to protect and defend the Crusaders and especially the pilgrims going overseas.
That is actually better than what's written on these cards. 10 points, Andrea. The Maltese Cross has its origins in the Crusades with the Order of St. John of Jerusalem. The order has its roots in 1080, when a group of monks opened a hospice for the growing number of sick and injured pilgrims arriving in Jerusalem. but the order soon extended to providing armed escorts, which then grew into a substantial military force known as the Knights Hospitallers. Even after they became a military order, they continued to run the hospital. And at that hospital, if they asked you to wait a few hours, you did what you were told. That's the story of the Maltese Cross.
Simple as that.
At least there was no booing this time, that's handy. So from that round, Michelle and Andrea picked up 30 points, Zora and Tony, no points. So the AD team are on 55 points and the BC team are on 10 points. So let's move on to our final round. It's a fast buzz-in round and I'll be asking 8 true or false questions. Teams, buzz in and tell me if you think the answer is true or false.
Let's get in. Get in, love. Look at me chumming up with my swarthy Italian and look at you trying to get away from the New Zealander. What's going on?
Question 1. When climbing the scaffold to be guillotined, Marie Antoinette accidentally trod on her executioner's foot.
True.
That is true.
To be either that or false, I think. I was gambling on it being one of those two.
The last words were said to be, Monsieur, I asked your pardon, I did not mean to do it. Question 2. Until the mid-19th century, any Japanese who tried to leave his homeland was summarily put to death.
We think it's true.
It is true.
There you go.
Question 3. Up until the 18th century, thermometers were filled with brandy instead of mercury. Michelle.
True.
It is true. Always love a thermometer that goes well with dry.
Yeah.
Question 4. Alexander Bell invented the telephone.
Tony. No.
No, he didn't.
No, he didn't.
No. In 2002, the US Congress recognised Antonio Meucci, an impoverished Italian immigrant, as the inventor of the telephone.
Finally, may
finally,
I just say.
Finally, Andrea.
Finally. One of the most famous Italians has been recognised. Great.
In the Middle Ages, barbers performed a number of medical duties, including bloodletting, wound treatment, dentistry, minor operations.
I think that's true.
That is true. The barber's striped pole originated in the Middle Ages when it was a staff the patient would grip while the barber bled the patient. Final question. King Henry VIII composed the tune Greensleeves.
False.
Zora. That is false. The first known mention of Greensleeves is in 1580, whereas Henry died in 1547, so...
And when that bloke invented the phone, that was the tune that he heard when he... I was confused.
The end of the show. Zora and Tony, 50 points for you tonight.
So we're the winners.
But our winners are the AD team of Michelle and Andrea on a 105 points. We'd like to thank our guests on the AD team, Dr. Andrea Rizzi and Michelle Laurie. And on the BC team, also a doctor, Dr. Zora Zimic and Tony Martin. Thanks for watching ADBC. And remember, those who do not learn from history are condemned to repeat it. With that in mind, we'll be back next week to do it all over again. My name was Sam Pang. Good night. Rush, rush, bang.
The food on this show is normally rubbish. This is actually quite good.
The thing I love about Florence Nightingale is that people have such an impression of, oh, isn't she sweet and she was a nurse. She was an asshole.
What do you see there, son?
I see a very, very poor package holiday. That's what I see up there.